Welcome to the Coast to Coast podcast, brought to you by PlayPicks and the Lines, coming to you from the West Coast. Josh Lander, joined by my guy Nate Weitzer on the East Coast, and we are talking Game 6, Bucks and Hawks Eastern Conference Finals. That's the only conference finals game that we have, that we have left, as the Suns await the winner of this one in the finals. We're going to go ahead and jump into a little bit about Game 5, as we saw that starless Game 5 go heavily in the Bucks' favor. We'll see if they can close things out in Atlanta or if the Hawks have something left in the tank for them. Make sure that you are liked and subscribed to that page. Jump in the comments, as we are going to offer a gift card opportunity here in just a moment. Need to be liked and subscribed to that page to be eligible. Jump in the comments and give us the prop that we'll offer here in just a sec. And as always, if you still need a FanDuel or DraftKings account, head to fdpicks.com or dkpicks.com. Find all those listings in your area. Nate, let's jump into this series in Game 6.
Yeah, pretty much a carbon copy in Game 5 in terms of one team does not have their star, but they come out on fire and never trail at home. So now we turn back to Atlanta with Giannis out, Trey very much questionable, and the Bucks are plus +2 underdogs in most spots. Total is 216.5. The Hawks are getting plus +350 odds to win both of these next two games. Their title odds have dropped from plus +600 to plus +1400. Bucks have climbed from plus +380 to plus +180 as they look to meet the Suns in the final. As far as Game 6, I mean, as what we were thinking in Game 5 too, is just watch what Jrue Holiday does. This is his show now, and it actually was one of those addition by subtraction things. Not to say Giannis is not a helpful player or that the Bucks are better in any way without him, but it does just change the nature of your offense. And for a guy like Jrue, it unlocks things. It gives you more space. It gives you more of a traditional role man in Brook Lopez. Both of those guys just dominated from the opening jump in just normal pick and roll situations. Budenholzer had a line to his guys before the game, you know, we're going to turn their pressure against them. And that's what he did with the Hawks, that these young guns trying to jump out, blitz pick and rolls, deny shots, thinking the Bucks are going to continue to chuck from deep, which they did not really. And they just dominated them in the paint, 66-36 advantage down low. Clint Capella looked all out of sorts. I guess that eye injury may be playing a factor. He had a 122 defensive rating. And Cam Reddish, after clamping down on Chris Middleton, goes from an 86 defensive rating to 118 as Middleton gets 26 points, 8 assists, along with Jrue Holiday's 25 and 13. Just an impressive performance from those two guys to step up without Giannis. And we harped on this. You know, we said the Bucks are going to shoot better from deep. Even though they didn't, it was that opening of the space that really allowed their offense to unlock. It was Pat Connaughton knifing Bryn Forbes, even though he did not score a lot, bringing some good floor spacing, yeah, and just allowing those guys to operate. I think because we trust those guards much better than the backups for Atlanta, or the backup ball handlers, now Bogdanovich and Herter thrust into the lead role, I think we trust the Bucks to close this out on the road. And even if Trae Young plays, I said to you, I think that might actually work against Atlanta. If he's not absolutely moving at full speed, then you have Trae maybe trying to do a little too much against a locked in Jrue Holiday, who now knows how to defend him pretty well with help. That could result in some costly turnovers and just kind of mess up the flow that Atlanta's developed, in these last two games without Trae Young.
Yeah, it's interesting. This is definitely a Jrue Holiday appreciation show, this particular episode. And I know we're both huge fans of Jrue and what he can do when he's got space. And to your point, he's bigger and stronger than most of the guys that are trying to guard him on Atlanta right now. And, you know, a couple of times you saw either Lou Will on one of the two of Chris Middleton or Jrue Holiday, and they just took him each time to the hole. And you saw the playmaking for both of those guys as well. That's what we looked for from Chris Middleton there. Actually, you know, his ability to pass out of those double teams that Atlanta kept throwing at him and still shoot 50% from the field was wildly impressive. What scares me, obviously, about Milwaukee winning this game is strictly how are their role players going to play on the road, as we know that Atlanta crowd will come out. They'll have that home court advantage and the role players that'll be getting big big minutes for Atlanta, will be a little bit more infused by that crowd as they were in game four. But I do think to the points that we were making about Milwaukee winning, they're a little bit more ready for this game without Giannis. I doubt that we'll see Giannis in this game. And like you said, even if we do see Trey as we're recording this, he's still questionable for that game, and likely will be pretty close up until, you know, game time, or at least until, you know, the afternoon heading into that game tonight. So I would say, you know, look, even if Trey's there, to your point, I'm not comfortable with Atlanta's offense. The over that we saw in this game, if Trey plays, I actually like the under, considering that I think this will get a little bit mucky, and I don't expect the same outpouring on offense from guys like Brooke Lopez necessarily in this game, and obviously Bobby Portis with his career playoff high as well. I think those guys are still going to be able to do well in the paint, but I do think that they're going to be a little bit more razzled than they were at home, and that leads me to go under. But I still think the combination of Jrue Holiday and Chris Middleton, who are now the two best players in this series, I think that gives Milwaukee that edge. You know, you and I were talking a little bit about the Bucks to win by 1 to 10 points. That's +200 on FanDuel. As we are saying, I am confident in the Bucks to close this out, a la the Suns, the way they close it out on the road in game six. And there's no way that they're blowing this team out by double digits on the road in a closeout game to this extent. There's too much fight in Atlanta, and they do too many things creatively on offense and defense with Nate McMillan to be able to sort of, you know, trump whatever it is that Mike Budenholzer throws at them. So, yeah, I would say that 1 to 10 plus 200 feels really, really nice right now. And then I'm also looking at some of those Atlanta props, because I think you'll still see Bogey scoring at 28 last game. And I think his prop, as we'll see it when it comes out, will probably be around 20 to 22 points. And I would feel good about the over there as well.
Yeah, I agree that we're going to see a low scoring game down the stretch, and I favor the Bucks in that instance. They actually lead the playoffs in overall defensive rating at 105, and it drops down to 102 in the fourth quarter, which is why we've seen so many unders. Last game went over because the Bucks came out on fire and never really relented. I don't know if I'm going to take under for the entire game, but I would look at live betting it. And what we've seen in the playoffs a lot is like, midway through the third quarter, like, there's no way this game's going under. And then all of a sudden, the clamps come on and people play defense and the refs let everything go. And, you know, the Bucks allow very few free throws, the least in the playoffs, at just 15 per game. Mm-hmm. The Hawks are not going to be getting to the line if Trae Young is not at his best. So I like to look at maybe live betting that under, maybe taking the Bucks at even money. If the momentum, it looks to be in the Hawks court because of that home crowd, sometimes you can get an advantage there. But I think Chris Middleton and Jrue Holiday are going to be your closers. And yep. I think that the Hawks are just going to be a step behind in terms of experience here, with Bogdanović and Herter not being the guys you're going to trust to close out a series in such a pressure situation.
100%. And so you're going to see the ball in the hands of Jrue Holiday and Chris Middleton. I would say, though, that clearly Nate McMillan's defensive scheme for a Giannis-less Milwaukee Bucks team is to take the ball out of Middleton and Holiday's hands where possible, with double teams, specifically Middleton getting double teamed every time he crosses half court, which does leave things open for Jrue. My main point here is, you know, I'm a little bit nervous about taking assists for either players, as I don't feel as comfortable with other guys on the Bucks making shots when they pass out of those double teams. But I do feel good about both of their points, rebounds, and assists because of the fact that their usage rates are going to be so high. They're both going to play 40 to 42, maybe 45 minutes in a closeout game. So they're not going, they're going to have the ball in their hands, and whether they're scoring or passing it to someone who's hopefully, you know, a lot more open, I think you can feel good about their hustle points and their assists. As I said, specifically, I want to make that the gift card here, Nate, for Jrue Holiday. Make sure you are liked and subscribed to the page to be eligible for the gift card. Jump in the comments. Let us know the total points, rebounds, and assists combined for Jrue Holiday in game six. I know we all are glowing about Jrue this after his impressive game five. So we'll look for another big one on the road from the now at least second superstar, if not number one banana, with the amount of time that he has the ball. ball in his hand. So we will be looking forward to all of those storylines. Game six, obviously, make sure to stay on top of thelines.com and see, you know, what that status is for Trey as we enter game six. Obviously, Giannis still questionable, more likely doubtful that we'll see him. But there is a possibility we'll see at least a hobbled Trey in game six. Make sure you stay tuned to that. That will affect all the game lines and probably a lot of player props as well. I know we'll be watching this one, Nate, as the playoffs roll on, and we'll be back with another video either for the finals or for a game seven in these Eastern Conference finals. And until then, happy betting.